We're going to move into two different panel conversations. The first is going to be talking about cancer at the state and at the policy level. We've talked a lot about community engagement around clinical trials. We've talked a lot about cancer disparities by community areas, even cancer disparities when it comes to funding. But we want to move the conversation now to talking about this bigger issue of policy, this bigger issue of city and state government as it relates to cancer. And we're fortunate to have two amazing panel representatives today. They're going to each provide about a 10-12 minute update on their work and their illustrious careers and how they've addressed this issue of health disparities and cancer disparities from the broader social determinants of health, and how they've addressed or used policy to try to change that and seen it in their work, and also talk a little bit about what should we be thinking about in this next era of policy at the state and national level. And so as I introduce our panelists, I'm going to ask them to take a place on the stage. We are very fortunate to have Dr. Terry Mason. And so many of us don't have to read Dr. Mason's bio. And I know personally he served as a mentor when I first got to Chicago. It was one of the names that you hear of someone that you must meet. And it's been an amazing opportunity for me to hear Dr. Mason's theory broaden even wider, if that is possible, with someone like him. And literally when I meet with him, I come prepared with a piece of paper to write things down, because he's always dropping what we call knowledge. It's always dropping knowledge, right? Those pearls that you have to just scoop up and just say, this is something I need to use. So Dr. Mason was appointed the Chief Operating Officer of the Cook County Department of Public Health in 2013, after serving more than 3 years as the Chief Medical Officer and 6 months as the Interim Chief Executive Officer for the Cook County Health and Hospital Systems. But before joining Cook County Hospitals and Health Systems, the Cook County Department of Public Health, Dr. Mason served as Commissioner of Chicago Department of Public Health. And so we're very thankful to have Dr. Mason, if you can join us on the stage today. And one of the things as he walks up that I also love about Dr. Mason is that he roots all the conversation as well as in history as well. He gives you a historical context to let you know that what you see is not just what you see today, but it's the issue that's been happening for long periods of time. So he also roots it in policy and conversation around history as well, which is another thing I love. Next, we have Dr. Allison Arwoody with us. Dr. Arwoody is the Chief Medical Officer at the Chicago Department of Public Health, where she oversees the health protection and health promotion bureaus, including the disease control, environmental health, emergency preparedness, behavioral health, and chronic disease program. She sees patients weekly at community health and has a particular interest in outbreak investigations and using data to promote health equity in Chicago. So thank you, Dr. Arwoody, for joining us today. And we also want to, in advance, our third panelist could not be here today and they are not feeling well, and they did let us know that it was okay. Dr. Shannon Leitner, the Deputy Director of the Illinois Department of Public Health, where she oversees the Office of Women's Health and Family Services, that includes programs such as the Illinois Breast and Cervical Cancer Program, the Family Planning Program, the Regionalized Perinatal Program, Maternal and Child Health Block Grant Program, and other programs aimed at improving the health of women and children in Illinois. So Shannon could not be here today, but we do want to thank her for her willingness to be here, and we wish her a quick recovery. So just want to start, the two of our panelists, if you could just provide a 10-minute overview about this concept of cancer public health initiatives and policy at the state, county, and city level, and what your various organizations have done to address that.
All right, sure. So hi, thanks so much for having me. It's really great to be here to see this partnership. I was able to sit in and hear some of the end of that discussion in the town hall meeting just now. And I know the Chicago Department of Public Health has already worked with a lot of folks here in this room. And so I just want to thank you individually and Chicago Check for the work that you're doing and the collaboration that you're doing with the Chicago Department of Public Health. So my name is Allison Arwoody. I'm the Chief Medical Officer, which means I work on a wide variety of things that the Chicago Department of Public Health is doing. As the health department, we take a population health approach to thinking about health in the city of Chicago. And many of you, I know, are aware of our plan, Healthy Chicago 2.0. I'm seeing some heads nodding. I'm sure there are names in this room that are also in this book. And I thought I'd maybe just take a couple minutes and tell you about how we sort of came together with this plan. This is the plan primarily from the Chicago Department of Public Health, but we really think of it as the city of Chicago's plan for the next 4 years. And the subtitle is Partnering to Improve Health Equity. And one of the real focuses right now at the health department is thinking in all of the programs that we do, how can we best address health equity? And whether that means, you know, our lead program focusing on parts of the city where there's old housing stock that may have a lot of peeling paint, maybe putting kids in those areas at high risk, or whether it's our some of our school-based programs recognizing that gay, bisexual, transgender kids are more likely to be bullied, have higher risk for suicide. It's taking the limited resources that we have available and putting them in the places where they're needed the most and make the biggest difference. And so what we did to sort of put this process a little closer, sure. Is that a little better? Sorry. People rarely tell me I'm too quiet, so. So what we did to put this plan together, so back in September 2014, we did a really big community health assessment. We talked to almost 1,000 public health stakeholders and residents, got a lot of input, looked at about 10 million data points, and came up with 10 priority action areas for Chicago. And five of those were in what we think of as sort of more traditional health areas. So things like promoting behavioral health, promoting chronic disease prevention with cancer prevention as a part of that, working on chronic disease, infectious diseases, child and adolescent health. We included violence prevention in there too, because I think you can't be in the city of Chicago and not make that a priority. But in addition to those more traditional health outcome-based approaches, we also thought a lot about the root causes. So specifically in this plan, we thought beyond what the health department, even the partners of the health department might do, to what other city agencies and other philanthropic and community organizations can do to work on things like working on education, social, economic, community conditions, and access to healthcare and human services. And then the final two pieces, we're making sure that we're doing a continuing to prioritize community engagement. This should not be a plan coming from above. It should be a plan really of all of ours. And then focusing on data, making sure that the health department is doing what we can to get the data that is telling the important stories for Chicago, and that our partners, academic and otherwise, who need particular data to tell a story, to get the grant, to work on a particular question, have it. And so we took these 10 areas, and then there were specific teams that over about 5 months developed very specific strategies, objectives and strategies. So we have 30 objectives for the whole plan to be done sort of by 2020, and then some strategies within that. So for this group, I'll tell you just a little bit about the cancer-specific ones. So one of our goals is to reduce the incidence of and inequities in invasive and late-stage cancer and cancer mortality. So that's a pretty big task. And the team worked on this. It would have had, you know, chair people from the department, but also from academic and community partners, as well as many people having input, really thought about what can we do, what can the public health population level do to work on this. And so the objectives that we came up with that is that by 2020, the goal across the city of Chicago is to increase breast cancer screenings among older adults by 5%. And you might say 5%, that doesn't really, you know, that doesn't sound like a lot. Everybody should really get breast cancer screening who's in the right age group. And we agree that that's true, but we also think that it's really important to be able to have goals that are measurable and that we know whether we're meeting them. Because honestly, I would love for 100% us to be able to reach 100%, but realistically, we've got the next 4 years to work on this. And so we looked at our data and we were able to say there are some potentially areas of the city that don't have as much access. We recognize that people who don't have health insurance are at a real, you know, have real issues accessing mammograms. So Chicago Department of Public Health, you know, is really committed, especially for folks who don't have health insurance, making free mammograms available, partnering with Mercy, with Cook County Health and Hospital, with Roseland, and making sure that those services are available for uninsured women. But more than that, that's sort of a citywide objective. We also focused that inequity piece because we know that outcomes are not the same. This isn't a group I need to talk about this with. I was looking at the posters in the hallway. But we know that in Chicago, African-American women have a 34% higher mortality rate for breast cancer than white women. And that's just not acceptable. And so thinking about strategies that we can do specifically working on that target and naming that, not saying we're gonna work on breast cancer mortality overall, we are, but we really think that the focus should be on some of that inequity. And so there's a goal there to reduce that breast cancer mortality specifically among African-American women by 10% by 2020. Then we have a benchmark. We sort of know if we're meeting a goal that is hopefully achievable. Additionally, we have a goal to increase cervical cancer screenings among adult females by 5%. And along with the cervical cancer work, obviously working on HPV vaccines. So I think everybody's probably aware, but human papillomavirus is a common virus sexually transmitted that puts people at increased risk for getting cervical cancer, and there's a vaccine available. So if young women get the 3 doses of the vaccine, ideally even before they're sexually active, they're protected against many strains of this human papillomavirus and therefore have much reduced risks of cervical cancer. And there are places around the world, Australia probably primarily among them, that have done a lot to make HPV vaccination absolutely routine, put in place very high rates, and they've seen their rates of cervical cancer go through the floor. So at the health department, where we think a lot about prevention, we really want to work on HPV, and we've already been working on it. So whereas nationally, only 40% of young women in that 13 to 17 age group are getting this cancer-preventing vaccine, in Chicago, we're at 53%. So better than the national average. It could have been one where we said, well, you know, we're doing okay in Chicago, but we feel so strongly that this is something that public health belongs in, and preventing cancer at the end of the day is even better than doing a good job of treating it, that we have a goal of reaching 80% by 2020 of young women in that 13 to 17 age group. And so to that end, we're doing things like routine provider education, a lot of work that as kids are coming in, this just becomes part of the routine vaccination, doing outreach to providers, doing an HPV public awareness campaign, especially in focused communities where we see lower rates, and thinking about policy opportunities. Can HPV become something that is a mandatory vaccine, for example, you know, going into a particular grade in high school, thinking about school locating HPV vaccination programs. So that's an example where we're saying there's something here, we're doing okay in Chicago, but we can do this much better. There's policy, community, provider approaches that all work together to get there. And so I think, you know,
we'll hit the last two, yeah?
Yeah, this is the last one, colon cancer screenings also, with a goal there of increasing screenings among older adults, specifically living in poverty, by 10%. We looked there and we were able to see that in Chicago, while 61% of adults age 50 to 70 are meeting colon cancer screening recommendations, Hispanics across the board, only 48% were. So that was an area to focus on. And then when we pulled together a lot of data and looked at some of the areas that, you know, are under high economic hardship, this strongly reflected much lower rates there. So we have some similar strategies to work in that areas. So I'll turn it over. I'll be happy to answer questions, but I hope I give you a sense of how we are really trying to use data to think about how we collectively as the health department, in partnership with all of you, can work to really reduce these important cancer disparities. Thank you
for that, Dr. Arwood. And we will have time for questions, and that's why we want to make sure that we give our panelists about 10 minutes to present, but then we'll open it up to questions from there. So Dr. Mason?
Thank you, Dr. Watson, and it takes me more than 10 minutes just to say hi, but for those of you who know me. But I want to echo my thanks to the organization that's pulled this together in this wonderful facility for facilitating an opportunity for us to have these conversations. A couple of things I'd like to say, you know, having been speaking about healthcare disparities now for nearly 25 years, So I'm old. And it's interesting that we have these recurring themes over and over and over again. We change the names. We talk about equity versus disparity. Though I know that there are differences, but when you're about around a long time, you see these themes continue to thread through what's going on. At the Cook County Department of Public Health, which is our jurisdiction is different. So the Cook County Department of Public Health has jurisdiction for all of Cook County, except where there is a certified health department. Chicago is one, Evanston, Stickney, Oak Park. There's a couple of others that'll come to me in a minute. But what we need to do is make sure that we really focus on suburban Cook County. It's still about 700 square miles, a population about 2.3 million people. But unlike the jurisdiction of Chicago, when I was Commissioner of Health for the City of Chicago, where we had one mayor, one police chief, one school board, we have 127 different municipalities. We have 95 school boards. We have just a hodgepodge of things that make the kind of planning that we'd like to do a little bit more difficult. But nonetheless, we move forward with our We Plan 2020. It has not been officially approved just yet by our boards, and it will be by the end of the year so that it will be available for public consumption. So I won't be able to go into the We Plan, but much of what you heard in terms of our looking at our population and using a map process where we brought in many, many, many stakeholders from across the county to address some of the concerns. At the same time, there was a crosswalk with the data that was collected on all of the health departments throughout the state of Illinois provided by the Illinois Department of Public Health. And there were a number of themes that were identified that we also built into this plan and tried to understand where there were appropriate synergies to make this work better. One of the areas that continued to percolate up a lot was chronic disease. The other one was behavioral health. So there are a number of things. So the county as a health system, though located in Chicago and some of its facilities in suburban Cook County, has always tried to play a role in dealing with chronic disease. And I think from a policy standpoint, the thing that's helped us the most, because before we were providing about $500 million worth of free care, was the introduction of the Affordable Care Act. And then our ability to go in as a early adopter through an 1115 waiver to enroll people early. And it gave us some really interesting insights. When you deal with people who have been traditionally locked out of the system, and you've got to remember men who were non-custodial parents, women who were non-custodial parents, and regardless of income, but if they were non-custodial parents, they were not part of our system, and that was independent of their status as whether they were citizens or not. So now we bring into the system a number of people who have been here for a long time and have been neglected. So you take African-American men who are non-custodial parents. And the other thing that the Affordable Care Act did is it allowed us to now bring people into a system where they could, that it was based on being poor. Before then, the only way you could get public aid or you could get Medicaid would be age old, blind, or disabled. And it didn't matter whether you were poor or not. In this one, being poor was one of the major drivers, as long as you met the other criteria, for enrollment into the program. So what we saw as people came in was the result of that neglect. We saw women who came in who had been bleeding down to hemoglobins of 5 and 6 and 7 and seen time and time again in our emergency department from this bleeding who were unable to access obstetrical care to manage that, now able to get that. We saw young men who had diabetes, high blood pressure, and now kidney failure, many of whom came in, and we had more people that we had that we wanted to go into dialysis. Now that's a clinical side, and I just wanted to put that out because there's two sides of this coin. What that points to is the problem that created that problem, and that's where this story goes. And doing these talks on healthcare disparities, you ask the questions: why do disparities exist? And the answer to that question is because they're supposed to. There's no way that you could look at the history of America, look at the differences between the way people of color have been treated, and I don't have time to go through my normal history lesson going all the way back to around 1619, but if you look at the way people have been treated and the fact that African Americans just got the right to go into public facilities 52 years ago, just the legal right to even walk in a facility 52 years ago, which is a very short time when you look. And so when we look at, and I'll make this real brief, Kareem, when I looked at data looking at health outcomes, and let's take as a surrogate for that death rates. So if you looked at death rates from cancer, looking at the American Cancer Society data, you would see death rates from blacks here, whites here, Hispanics here, and Asians there. And so my question always has been, and what we've tried to do and sort of weave this through the fabric of some of the planning, is we really need to look very closely at this. Because what does that say? So if the death rates for cancer from whites are here, and the death rates from blacks are here, and Hispanics are here, and Asians are here, then why is the comparator white? Because the comparator really ought to be the people who have the best outcomes. And then we should be measuring our disparities against that. Does that make sense to anybody? Mm-hmm. So if we did that, we would say that whites really had a real bad situation. Because if we think about it, and in terms of, because we always get into this racial argument, the disparities between whites and blacks, well, when I think about the way, and I don't have time to go through all of that, but if I think about sort of the struggles that blacks in this country have had to face, and the fact that our health outcome, the death rates from cancer in particular, are not that much different than whites, that really says something either really good about blacks or really bad about whites. Only because if you had all of the power, all of the opportunity, all of the hospitals, access to all the care, all of the things were in your favor, and yet your health outcomes were here in terms of cancer mortality, we as a country have a problem. Because this to me says that there's something screaming, that there's something really, really wrong. And that we really need to approach the whole disparities or equities conversation, if you will, in a different sort of way. And so what that means to me is that we need to retell the story, re-level set this whole thing, and redefine what healthcare disparities are, because I don't, and perhaps it's because I'm much older now, I don't feel bound to go by, other than that that's what's published these days and that's what you have to follow. So when you begin looking at this globally, you see another kind of pattern emerge. And what's that pattern? Well, if you look at the United States, in terms of spending dollars, we're about $3.2 trillion in terms of spending. And we spend more than any other country in the world. And yet our health outcomes are now somewhere around 40th. That's in terms of this life expectancy. And if you look at one of the best websites I know, and that's the Central Intelligence Agency website, the CIA website, which keeps data on over 224 countries, gives you life expectancy by two decimal places, and it's updated far more frequently than the CDC website, you'll see another pattern emerge, that all of the countries with the lowest life expectancy, and the gap is about 40 years difference between Macau, Japan, and some of the countries like Lesotho in Africa. So all of the countries with the lowest life expectancy on the planet are all countries where black people live, all of them. If you look at and I'm saying the gap is 40 years in terms of life expectancy. So at 89 for the top life expectancy in the world to 40 as the top life expectancy in some of the countries of African descent. So this, to me, paints a different global picture. Now let me just bring this back to what we're looking at here. Tomorrow, actually, one of the things that I have come to learn over time is that we have downplayed the role that food consumption plays in all of our disease processes, be it cancer or be it so-called heart disease or so-called stroke or so-called peripheral vascular disease, all of these diseases have a very strong component rooted in our food. And so tomorrow, just as an aside, we're having our first food summit at Loyola University, the School of Medicine, bringing in people from all over the country to discuss this. People like T. Colin Campbell, the author of the China Study, and we're bringing in people like Richard Oppenlander, who's going to talk about environment. But nevertheless, what's really important is we have to begin to think about, and that's one of the things in our chronic disease plan that you're going to see, is that we've really got to look at food access. And one of the things that the county has already begun to do is we've begun to do a food screening, a food security screening in our clinics. Because we have people that are not only not eating good food, but there are a lot of people who are coming to our clinic who have no food. Mm-hmm. And food insecurity is a major problem. It doesn't matter how many pills you give somebody. It doesn't matter about all that if they have to worry about where their next meal is going to come from. And that meal may not be the kinds of foods that are going to help them. So now in all of our in our clinics, we are doing this food insecurity screening. We teamed up with the Greater Chicago Food Depository mm-hmm. and one of the cooking programs. We have the fresh truck that comes out. And once in a while, this truck and this food van makes its rounds around our different clinics so that we can supply our fresh fruits and vegetables to the constituency. In the Maywood area, we've also been looking at food literacy, mm-hmm. trying to determine what are the real drivers of food literacy, and we'll be presenting at the AP, American Public Health Association, a paper looking at food literacy in three different communities. Maywood, a community, now I'm having, this is a sign of really getting old, but three communities looking at the differences. One, Maywood in this western part of the western suburbs. The other one looking at a south suburban Markham, looking at Markham, and the other one looking at a very well-to-do suburb further north to look at the differences in food literacy. And you'd be surprised that the differences aren't as striking as you might think they would be. And so we are a country that has some real issues around understanding food literacy, understanding the role that food plays in dealing with our diseases, and I refuse to accept the fact that Americans are too stupid, too lazy, too unwilling to make the appropriate changes. I'll close with one statistic, and I was at the Breast Cancer Task Force last night, and one of the things that struck me in my research, particularly looking at breast cancer, because you've rightly pointed out the disparities are marked. But there's a paper that talked about that women who have fewer than three bowel movements a week have a nearly five times greater risk of developing breast cancer. That's striking to me. That's a major public health statement. Mm-hmm. And that statement is rooted in, and I'm not going to go through it because I said I wouldn't go for it too over my time. But what I will say is that is because of the reabsorption of bile acids. Yeah. Back into the system, and those bile acids, and there have been several other papers that shown that these bile acids create an estrogenic-like effect on some of the cyst in the cyst of the breast and create a cancerous change. And the simple way to deal with this is going back looking at things like intestinal stasis that was published in the British Journal of Medicine in 1909. Where for intestinal stasis, where people didn't have bowel movements for 28 days, the surgeons used to do a total colectomy, removing the entire colon, thinking that it wasn't necessary. So I just want to say this, that this is a very strong, in my mind, a very strong indicator in terms of what we might need to do in thinking about how we change and re-message some of the things in ways that people can understand it. Because the challenge there is, all we need to do to change that outcome is to do something very simple. We need this, and we don't need to go to the pharmacy, P-H-A-R. We need to go to the F-A-R, pharmacy, and get the fruits and the vegetables that we all know that we need. And those things will probably do more to help us prevent cancer than almost anything else that we're going to do. doesn't mean that we don't get the early detection modalities. And we got to remember, we have to be careful how we message this to the public. Early detection is not prevention. So these are early detection modalities. You can have 100 mammograms, it won't prevent one breast cancer. You can have 100 colonoscopies, it won't prevent one colon cancer. You can take 1,000 PSAs, it won't prevent one prostate cancer. We have to make sure that the American public understands what the tests mean, and their early detection, not prevention. So with that, I'll stop.
All right, thank you, Dr. Mason. So I'm actually, thank you all. I had some prepared questions, and like I said, I'm so happy that Dr. Mason and Lilly, they both need a full day, and they actually will have that tomorrow. So I want to replug that event that's happening at Loyola University Medical School tomorrow, starting at 9 a.m. 1 p.m. That's about the time he needs, actually, for it to start at 1 a.m. and just do an all-nighter. But in the interest of time, I want to open the floor up to questions right now. And for your questions, think about framing your questions in the context of county and city policy levels. For example, we heard about Chicago, Healthy Chicago 2.0. So think about framing your questions in the term of the Cook County Department of Public Health and the Chicago Department of Public Health, and what you as either a community or academic partner need, or how you see that there's alignment there. It's what we call in our cancer center the and conversation, right? We don't get the luxury in Inglewood of just focusing on the colon cancer rates in Inglewood. I also have to think about food insecurity in Inglewood. I have to think about workforce development in Inglewood and the opportunity to develop jobs around this whole issue of health inequities. So as you've bring your questions, there's a mic there. Please come to the podium if you have questions.
Hi, I'm Catherine O'Brien, and I'm with the Metastatic Breast Cancer Network, and we are a patient-led advocacy group for people living with stage 4 breast cancer. And everyone in our group are people who have stage 4 breast cancer. That being said, my bowels are good, so that wasn't it. My question is, in terms of, you both talked a lot about data, and the fact is today, we say or estimate that there are 155,000 people living with stage 4 breast cancer, which is the fatal form of the disease. We don't actually know, because SEER, our National Cancer Registry, mm-hmm. it does not count. It counts incidence and initial treatment, and then mortality. But most people with stage 4 breast cancer were treated for early stage breast cancer, but they had a metastatic recurrence. So my point in all that is, on a national level, we are not counting people. And you know, we can't manage what we don't measure. So my question would be, is at the local level, is there a better or a more, say, accurate database really counting what's going on? Because just as you were both saying, we know that more white women will get breast cancer, but more African-American women will die from it. And just as Dr. Murray was saying this morning, I think that's a social justice issue. But on a fundamental level, I don't know that we have a great count. And then if I could just ask one other question. It's true that just as you were saying that mammograms are not fail-proof, but that's for breast cancer, that's the best that we have right now. But my concern would be, if we are doing more screening, could we not get better screening in underserved communities, not just a mammogram, but it seems as though better testing would be needed, maybe a 3D mammogram or an ultrasound, but it just seems like, and then what happens when you give somebody a mammogram and they're diagnosed? Now what? Now they have to get to treatment. They have to pay for treatment. And it just seems like oftentimes that's the first thing that we hear is screening, but there doesn't seem to be a lot of connecting the dots between that. So
I want to summarize your question. And two, before I let our panelists answer, I'd always like to translate, if you will. So we heard this term SEER, and many of our partners may not know what that term stands for, but SEER is Surveillance Epidemiology in Result Data. Surveillance Epidemiology in Results Data. It's an acronym for data that's collected at the NCI level, right? So when we talk about data, you'll hear us talk about secondary data sets. These big, large data sets, and one of the things is that we're often not a part of that because sometimes to get a part of these data sets, you have to be either at the table through a clinical trial or some other way for that data to be reported to the NCI. So I just want to frame that conversation and give our panelists opportunity to answer that. So one of the questions first started off was about this issue of data. How can we get better data, and how can we partner with the city and the county to look at data differently, more granularly, if you will?
So first, I thought it was an excellent question. I think there are so many things we would like to know more about. And as technology grows, I think as the possibility to eventually be able to have better linkage between electronic medical records and public health reporting, for example, comes in, I hope in time we are going to be able to have more of exactly that kind of data to answer those questions. Right now, many of our reporting structures are based on these very big population questions, and we don't get down to that granularity in a way that we would love to. I think part of this is why we turn to the research community, you know, like CHECK is really supporting, to make sure that these more granular questions are really being addressed, and as things are being found that can then kind of make their way back into policy, make their way back into public health. That's certainly one approach. I will say that at the Chicago Department of Public Health, we recognized that there was a need to have some more Chicago-specific data. It wasn't about that particular issue necessarily, but we do a lot of taking whatever is available federally and from the state, but we actually developed a survey that we now do in the city of Chicago annually, focusing especially on some of the violence issues, on things that we're not getting from the federal data, and we want to really understand more at a neighborhood to neighborhood level. And we're just in the second year of doing that now, but it's something we're very committed to over time, being able to grow and answer the questions that we really need to know about Chicago that don't get necessarily asked or we don't understand as well, and building some of that homegrown data. So I think that we're in the infancy of doing that, but it's something we're committed to and certainly looking for research partners like CHECK.
Yeah, I think that, again, it was a great question, and I just wanted to make a point about the women and not being able to get the appropriate treatment. The Illinois Breast and Cervical Cancer Program was started to help facilitate those problems and to remove those, help to remove those barriers. Our departments, I'm sure both in the city when I was there and of course the city and of course the county, we are participants in the Illinois Breast and Cervical Care Program. So we should be able to remove almost any barrier that any woman has to treatment. That being said, the Breast Cancer Task Force will be the first to tell you that all breast cancer treatment is not equal.
That's right.
And there are differences in the quality of that treatment. And there's differences as in going back some years, remembering going through this information with Dr. Ansel, who is one of the medical people that's part of the Breast Cancer Task Force. We learned a couple things. Number one, that the quality of mammography varied from parts of the city, where you got it done, how you got it done. But even not only the quality of mammography, it is the interpretation of the mammography. Mm-hmm. So those were some problems. And I really, there's a great debt of gratitude that we should have for the Breast Cancer Task Force for bringing these problems to the light so that they could be addressed. What they tried to do was to make certain that you had mammography being looked at by radiographic mammographers, that are people who are specifically trained, because there are some subtle changes that may not be seen. And let me just say parenthetically, my remarks about what the numbers of mammography and PSA as not to be taken that I don't believe that we should do these, that I absolutely do believe that this is important to do. But we also have to realize the limitations of those things. Secondly, is equity in treatment of the breast cancer and having all of the options available to you. So those are some of the things that don't go into data. And last point about the data is most of the American College of Surgeons certifies cancer centers and their data. And so the data acquisition is always local. So a hospital, when you go to hospital X and you have a biopsy and it's positive and then they do whatever they do and then it's staged, all of that information has to be input by that facility. Mm-hmm. So, and if whatever treatments and how long and things of that nature. So I'm saying that the data that we end up with at the end is only as good as the data that went in the beginning.
Yes.
And I'm not trying to say that we don't do a good job. I'm just saying that there are problems and challenges along the way. And I think what the task force is trying to do is normalize, or try to at least normalize, breast cancer treatment. And a big part of that is making sure that every woman or anyone with a partner who has breast cancer has at least availability of all the information that they need to be able to make the kinds of decisions to hopefully make certain that they're getting the appropriate treatment, right time, and right place, and also that they're getting the follow-up that's needed. Now, how we deal with this counting artifact, because you go in and you're initially stage, let's say first stage or second stage, but then when you come back and you're stage four, that's not usually done by the surgeons who saw you the first time. That's usually done by someone else down the line. And to make sure that that data gets updated at the source level is sometimes perhaps where there may be some other areas for us to improve.
I think as we wrap this up, I think a big take home message here is trying to really this conversation that, and again, this point of today is to begin the conversation, not to end the conversation. We don't want to make it seem like there's a lot of answers start, but a lot of questions, but also thinking about it. And I hope our community members in the room walk away hearing this term data differently, right? Because typically data can sometimes be a scary word. Many of those of us, particularly from a marginalized group, we don't want to be data, because historically being data hasn't always been beneficial to us, so we thought, because the process to become data was not a social justice issue. But data is so important, and I'll close by talking about what Dr. Mason talked about, these commission on cancers. So as a patient, you can advocate and ask your medical center where you get your treatment, are you certified by the Commission on Cancer? Because if you're getting your treatment at a center that's certified as a Commission on Cancer, we're required to collect certain information and report that information back. So that's one way to get local data as well, is to go through your health facility and find out if you are certified through the Commission on Cancer, as Dr. Mason talked about, through the American College of Surgeons, where that data goes into. But then also, this is a call for you to participate when you get that email, when you get that phone call, to find out, saying, will you be willing to answer these questions, for us to really think about, is this an opportunity for me to provide data? Is this an opportunity for me to have my voice at the table, so that when these conversations are had at the larger data set, I can't say I wasn't included? I'm the son of a survivor, right? My mother died of breast cancer. My father died of complications from colon cancer. My brother's dealing with colon cancer right now. So yes, I went into a registry, because it was important for me to go into that registry and give my data and have information for people that look like me, so we can know what that looks like. So I want to thank our panelists right now for this amazing beginning of the conversation. And it's not ending, because we're going to bring up Commissioner Garcia right now to continue the conversation for another 15 minutes or so. And I will ask our current panelists to stay up as Commissioner Garcia makes his way to the panel. Because we're going to continue this conversation with Commissioner Chuy Garcia, Commissioner Jesus Chuy Garcia, the Cook County Commissioner of the 7th District. Commissioner Garcia currently serves as a commissioner for the 7th District on the Cook County Board of Commissioners. He's a progressive leader who has fought to improve the lives of all people. Commissioner Garcia was born in a village at the edge of the Sierra Madre in Durango, Mexico. And when he was 10, he settled in Pilsen and then the Little Village neighborhood. Doesn't need that much of an introduction. So in the interest of time, we want to thank Commissioner Garcia for being here and to talk about his work. And we actually just want you to talk a little bit more about, as we open up continue the conversation about this issue of health disparities in the county area and this issue of inequity.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for that introduction. I'm delighted to join the conversation this afternoon, and of course truly delighted that this initiative by three universities, one private and two public, is moving forward recognizing inequities and, more importantly, inequities in the area of cancer, how it affects communities in the metropolitan area, and how we move forward. So I want to commend everyone here for their work and their thoughts and their initiative as we move forward as a community. I am in complete support of the four primary aims of this initiative, which are, of course, to establish a transdisciplinary disparity research programs in behavioral and social and biomedical and translational science, to mobilize the overall community, be it researchers, educators, community leaders, students, et cetera. And I think I'll talk a little bit more about that because that's sort of where I come from. That's the cloth that I'm cut from. And then, of course, providing training, mentoring, and learning to recruit and retain minority and underrepresented students in the field of health and cancer research, and of course, to support faculty and scientists, minority faculty and scientists. So I wanna begin by sharing with you some good news as I see it, as it relates to the Cook County Board of Commissioners and initiatives underway that aim to address the social determinants of health, and especially as it relates to things like cancer in our community, because I think we're doing some unprecedented things as Cook County government goes or has gone so far, and I think embarking on some new initiatives that we ought to be collaborating on. Number one, we're reducing the jail population at 26th and California. Why is that significant to this? Because of the overrepresentation of people of color. The overwhelming majority of the jail population are males and primarily African American and Latino. That is one indicator that has to be addressed. We're trying to do that. We've decreased the jail population over the past 2 years by 2,000, and it will continue to go down, especially as greater awareness about incarceration across the country continues to be the new norm. The creation of a land bank in Cook County. This is also another important achievement in this regard, recognizing that there are too many abandoned buildings and vacant properties in Chicago, South Side and West Side in particular, in some suburban communities, those with the lowest incomes, for example, where you also have, in addition to concentrations of poverty, the highest rates of violence, et cetera. The creation of the land bank helps us take property, clean title, put them back to productive uses, housing, business, retail, in addition to industrial uses. We have a new transportation plan. Why is it significant? Because we haven't had one in Cook County for over 70 years. And one of the important aspects of it is it recognizes the need for transit in order for people to have an opportunity to go from job-starved areas of the county to job creation centers in the county. We also have a new social innovation commission. I am the chairman of that commission as the chairman of the Committee on Business Economic Development. The goal of this commission is to bring economic development activities to areas that haven't seen it in such a long time, to address the concentration of poverty, particularly in the west and south sides of Chicago and the poorer suburbs in the county. Our goal will be to look at starting some initiatives in these places. The Illinois Medical District we see as one important accelerator of job creation. The fact that the new Malcolm X College and its focus on nursing and health is so important, but you'll soon see some other things going on here. I'll be right back to that. But we also will be dealing with next Wednesday an ordinance that seeks to provide earned sick pay for all workers in Cook County for a maximum of 5 days. The role of this ordinance, the goal of this ordinance rather, is to enable people to take care of their health, to care for their loved ones, be they their spouses, other immediate relatives, et cetera. We think it's also another important investment in healthcare. Hope it passes. Lobby your commissioner if you think this is a good idea. Partnerships and collaboration are also critical. We have, I think, a very unprecedented partnership right here where we are today, the Illinois Medical District. The Board of Commissioners and the Cook County Health and Hospital System Board share a mission, and that mission is to provide health care to all, regardless of their ability to pay, and to treat them with dignity. We have had that mission in place for a long, long time. In the Stroger campus over the next 10 years, you'll see some significant developments. Over $700 million will be invested in this area, including in the building of a new central campus health center, which will be the home of the primary health system in Cook County, the 16 clinics across Cook County that rely on this system for its support. But it will also be an upgrade and expansion of the network of clinics in Cook County, 16 of them, the primary healthcare clinics. This is important because it will also come with an expansion of services, including weekend and evening hours, mental health services, very, very important, as we have learned over the past several years, and oral and dental health care, which many clinics have not provided for a long, long time. There'll also be the opening of a new triage center in Roseland, which will focus on mental health and substance abuse. This will be a support center for people who have these afflictions and who are released from Cook County Hospital, and oftentimes, because of the closure of mental health clinics and that, don't have a place to support them during their hour of need. We'll be working with a network of community providers in addition to that. We also passed, just 2 weeks ago, a direct access program ordinance, which seeks to address the uninsured in Cook County. During a one-year period beginning in January, we hope to sign up to 40,000 people, primarily African American and Latino immigrants, as well as other immigrants in Cook County, so that they can be enrolled in the local primary care clinics and have full access to the system. This is seen as being proactive and primary health care oriented. So very significant development that occurred there. What do I really want to tell you today, besides bearing some good news and beginning on an optimistic note? The following: that I truly believe that addressing the social determinants of healthcare in Chicago, Cook County, and in the metro area requires addressing those social conditions in neighborhoods and areas of the city and county. One of the best experiences that I've had in this regard was in my prior life as a community development practitioner, fighting along with neighborhood residents of the Little Village community for a Little Village Lawndale High School. It was in the Little Village community, a great experience that required a 19-day hunger strike to make it happen, to shame CPS and other key power brokers in the city to build a promised high school in that community. What came from that was a brand new facility, a campus of four small schools within a shared facility. But more importantly, we were quickly tested after the school was about to open, in that some people, especially politicians, wanted to change the attendance boundaries because the attendance boundaries were to include children from the North Lawndale community. And some people said this school should only be for the Little Village kids, meaning Mexican and Mexican-American kids in Little Village. We resisted that effort. It resulted in a referendum being held. Over two-thirds of the community, mostly in the Little Village area, rejected this referendum because of the racial undertones, because it would mean segregating children and not giving them the opportunity to learn in a setting where it was welcoming, where you learn about the world around you, other communities in Chicago, and it would be a blow against segregation and racism in Chicago. What came out of this fight was significant. Because of that, we became a better community. We created the state-of-the-art campus in Chicago, but more importantly, or additionally important, were the fact that we engaged in a variety of partnerships that the communities had not known before. What were they? Partnerships with colleges and universities, similar to what is going on here. partnerships with Chicagoland foundations and other institutions like banks and insurance companies. This is a part of what occurred as a result of this struggle and this process. This is significant because in Chicago, it is critical that African Americans and Latinos, being the majority of the population of the city of Chicago alone, need to find greater understanding, build greater trust and collaboration. It is possible. As a matter of fact, this weekend, the Latino Policy Forum is bringing together a group of Latino and African American community activists for a weekend engagement that will continue after this to find ways to build those relationships, to set agendas on how we can engage local policymakers, state policymakers, and national policymakers to build this type of trust. Why is this important? Because in order for neighborhood transformation, in order to have equitable and balanced development in Chicago that benefits the neighborhoods that have not seen economic prosperity, you need that as basic building blocks. It will transform the city of Chicago, and I think that these are the types of social determinants that must be addressed in order to make our initiative here more successful, be able to be rooted in neighborhoods and engage the institutions, the most basic institutions in those neighborhoods. What are they? Block clubs, community gardens, local school councils, churches, all the organizations that exist there that are a natural ally to making this initiative the successful and transformative initiative that it can be. I want to commend everybody who is a part of this. This is what I think is critical as we move forward. And finally, because the Mr. Moderator is giving me the look, I want to continue to encourage all the stakeholders here to develop a cancer policy and action agenda and to expand our activities. I was going to say your activities, but it's about all of us, our activities to include other sectors such as Chicago's robust business community, employers, community and professional organizations not involved in the area of healthcare to address cancer health inequities and to propose regulatory, administrative, and legislative health and social policies to elected and appointed officials to achieve a zero cancer disparities in our communities. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that. I'm gonna, in the interest of time, we have our survivor panel following this and to talk about the concept that cancer does not discriminate. If in the spirit of action, if our panelists can just each in a minute or so, just summarize what action steps would you like to see come out of this conversation? Or what call to action would you like to give to each of us, whether we're a community or academic partner today, as we go back to our institutions or back to our communities to begin to think about how we can move this needle in terms of cancer health equity? So we'll start with Dr. Mason in terms of the call to action.
You know, my lens is always around food.
I do.
So I think that what I would like to see and what I'm going to spend the rest of my life working on is making sure that we can have organic, low-cost, widely available food. If we want to change the paradigm of the way people eat, we have to make it cheap, we have to make it widely available, and we have to have it of high quality. Those were the things, and then educate people on exactly, in a culturally sensitive way, because everybody doesn't eat the same thing, but in a culturally sensitive way, how do you begin to incorporate and encourage that? And of course, the drinking of water. That to me will do, and of course, I'm not discounting treatment and all the other things, but those to me are the things that will work on the preventive side. And from the data that I'm reading, it also seems that will help even on those who've been diagnosed.
Thank you for that.
So I think this is such a strong group because you bring a lot of different voices to the table. Your roles as survivors, your roles as advocates, your roles as researchers can mean that sometimes you can have some splintered sort of recommendations, I would really encourage you as a group to try to come with one or two policy-driven recommendations that you would like the Chicago Department of Public Health, the Cook County Department of Health, the Illinois Department of Public Health to really use on your behalf. So take all of these different voices together and try to come up with just a very focused goal, and then together we can work to try to achieve it.
All right, thank you, Commissioner Garcia.
The crisis of violence in the city in particular will continue to be an issue that we'll have to grapple with for the foreseeable future. I think that as we see more calls to action emanating from neighborhoods across Chicago and, you know, spilling into suburban communities, we ought to look for those individuals who spearhead, who participate in those actions. Why? Because they understand that a community cannot be hopeful, a community cannot thrive, a community can't become a place that improves the quality of life unless everyone becomes an active stakeholder and everyone can be moved and motivated to take action. So looking for additional partners and collaborators to become a part of this initiative will be critical, and many opportunities will be on the horizon.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Let's give another round of applause for our illustrious panel. And again, I want to announce Dr. Mason's session tomorrow at Loyola Medical Center in Maywood, correct? From 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. And then Saturday all day starting, and that's when it starts at 9 a.m. on Saturday. All right. Thank you all. And if we can have our survival panelists, please make your way up. Ms. Tasha Joyner, Elizabeth Rivera, Yan Fing Lee, and Christopher Carlisle. Cancer does not discriminate. And you've heard a lot to the conversation today about, you've heard a lot of conversation today about the fact of making sure this project is represented. So first we have Ms. Tasha Joyner. And Ms. Joyner is a devoted wife and loving mother and a 13-year breast cancer survivor and a community activist. So we're very thankful to have Tasha Joyner here today. And Elizabeth Rivera is a mother, speaker, author, and educator and entrepreneur. And is also this author, and this life-altering experience of being a cancer survivor has allowed her to find her purpose and passion. And she owns and operates A&E Language Academy in Illinois and has written a book called Damaged Goods, A Story of a True Survivor. And Yang Fin Lee was diagnosed with breast cancer in 2010 and was treated at Mercy Hospital and Medical Center and has been active in the Chinese Cancer Support Group at the Chinese American Service League and stays active by doing Tai Chi, walking and dancing. And then we have Mr. Christopher Carlisle, is a 10-year, three-time cancer survivor who was first diagnosed with non-Hodgkin lymphoma in 2006 and then in 2007 was diagnosed with throat cancer followed by renal cancer in 2008 and has really been active with Gilda's Club. So we want our survivor panels to share the story and to provide a face to the diversity and the fact that cancer does not discriminate. And although we have diversity represented here today in racial and ethnic diversity, we would be remiss to say that we like to think about diversity even beyond race and ethnicity, but thinking about those community areas that are lacking diversity as well, thinking about those people who don't have access, who may live in rural America, who may not differ in racial and ethnic diversity, may have issues in access. So with that, our panelists, thank you so much for your coming here today to be a part of this conversation. And if you all could just briefly, in 2 minutes, tell a little bit about your story, something I call sharing your story. So we'll start with you, Tasha.
Hi, Karina. It's
Hello.
Good to see you.
It's good to see you, too.
2 minute elevator story, right? I'm a 13-year breast cancer survivor. I was diagnosed at the age of 36 when my only child was 8 months old. I nursed my son for the first 8 months of his life, and soon as I finished nursing him, I got the news that I had breast cancer in my milk duct. So, of course, being a first-time mom, extremely nervous, never having heard about breast cancer in my family, I was a statistic at the age of 36. So my life mission is to celebrate my life every single day and to make sure every woman, including men, get tested. My mantra is know your body, and do not just know your body, understand the functionality of your body. I know I am a female. The function of my breast was to feed my child. The function of my body is to bring forth a child. So I know my body and I understand why my body was designed. And I also want women and men to understand that the importance of health and communication with people in your circle is extremely important. Unfortunately for me, I was not able to have more children because of my breast cancer. But what I did was I celebrate life every day, and I empower, inspire, and encourage everyone in my life to do the same. I love people, I love life, and being a survivor has truly given me a new outlook on life. I can't stress enough how surviving breast cancer has given me so much more than just waking up every morning. It's no longer about me, it's also about my child. So I didn't care if the doctor told me to cut all five of my fingers off and drink my blood. I needed to survive, not just for me, but for my family. So in closing, I just want everyone to know, take care of you. If you feel a pain, do not dismiss that pain, because you know that pain is not supposed to be there. Again, knowing and understanding your body. Know your body and understand your body. Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Thank you, Kareem, for inviting me to be part of this panel. My name is Elizabeth Rivera, and my story is a little different. I am a person that goes to the doctor religiously, and I was displaced from my job when I was in corporate America and did not have insurance for 2 years. So I did not want to create any bills for my family, so I didn't go to the doctor. Once I was employed again, after a few months, I went ahead and had my mammogram in February of that year, in 2011, and it was negative. Then in June, I decided to reinvent myself, and I was going to start my own business, but it required that I needed an exam. So I went to see my primary doctor, and this was a new primary doctor, and she was a female this time. I've always had male primary doctors, not to say anything bad about male doctors, but the female doctor, she insisted that she examined me. And I told her that I just had, proudly, I said, I just had a mammogram and it was negative. So she says, no, my new patients, I have to examine them. She examined me and found the lump. I had this huge cloud above my head. All I kept thinking about was, oh my God, I won't see my children, have children, and you know, who's gonna take care of my mother? And just so many things, my whole life was flashing in front of me. She says, oh, don't worry, it's probably nothing. So I went through my series of exams, my ultrasound. I had another mammogram, so they did a comparison. I did this ultrasound and come to find out that I had not one lump, I had two lumps. And then it was like everything was caving in and I had to see all this slew of doctors. And then I had to have an MRI to be just absolutely sure that I only had two lumps. Come to find out I had four lumps. So from having the option of a lumpectomy to no option at all, now I cannot save my breasts, to having my breasts removed. And as vain as I was like, what am I gonna do? I don't have no breast. I was not thinking about saving my life at that time. I had to rethink everything and say, oh God, please give me direction. And then it came to me, I'm like, well, if I have to have one removed, I'm having both removed. Get it all out. And so doing this and going through chemo, which people do not understand unless you go through it. I don't care how much medical history you have behind you or how many people you've helped. you do not know what a cancer survivor has gone through. And everybody goes through a different cycle, a different journey. And so it not only affected me, just like Tasha said, it affected her son, it affects your family, it affects your whole world, your relationships, your friends. You'll have friends that disappear, family members that won't even want to handle you. My children were 16 years old. They grew up to be men overnight. I have twin sons. One would bathe me, and the other one could not stand the sight of blood. So he would just, you know, cook for me and do whatever. Everybody had a role to play. Mm-hmm. And so for me, I'm not saying that cancer was a blessing, but it did make me a different person. And today it's made me the person who I am. I became an author. I put all of my pain that was festering in, that a lot of survivors have. Some of them are still angry. They have nowhere to put it. I put it in a book to inspire others and to inspire myself as I'm writing, and I let it go. And today I'm stress-free. I love my life. I met Kareem.
You can get a copy of this book next Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. next Friday at our Breast Cancer Survivorship Celebration. That book will be on sale.
So thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone.
So I felt my lump in 2010 when I was in the shower.
當時呢,我就好驚,就唔知點算就去行人街嗰個唔遺傳嗰個婦科醫生度睇.
I was very, very scared at the time and I didn't know what to do, so I went to a gynecologist in Chinatown, Dr. Wu, to be seen by him.
醫生就建議我去Mercy醫院度檢查.
So Dr. Wu suggested for me to go to the Mercy Hospital for a checkup.
檢查之後呢,醫院呢就認為我呢就要做嗰啲活檢,咁檢咗之後就證實我就係有乳癌.
The hospital suggested to have biopsy, and after the biopsy result came out, it was verified that I have breast cancer.
咁咧就好驚啦！咁醫生咧建議我咧就兩個選擇，一就切除局部就要電療，就要化療；咁第二個咧就係要成邊切除咧就做化療。
And I was very scared. The doctor suggested either I can have a lumpectomy with radiation and chemo, or have a mastectomy with chemo.
咁咧，我就選擇咗咧，就一邊切除，咁咧做化療.
So I chose to have mastectomy with chemo.
咁咧，竟然咧就有乳癌啦，就一定要聽醫生嘅話.
So since I have breast cancer, I have to follow the doctor's direction.
咁咧就配合醫生咁做完手術切除之後就做化療.
So I followed the doctor's advice. After the surgery, I went through chemotherapy.
咁化療咗16次.
I had 16 session of chemotherapy.
化療期間咧真係好難受，就咧要自己堅持，就同埋家人嘅支持。
During the chemotherapy, it was very difficult. I had to be strong. I needed the support of the family and friends. I needed everyone to take care of me, ask me how am I doing, and I just have to keep going.
咁咧就化療期間咧，自己儘量咧就要做一啲有氧嘅運動。 要配合醫生，比如打氣極啊、散步啊，要喐下手腳啊，呢啲醫療要配合醫療，一定要做嘅呢啲。
I was following the doctor's advice, but I was also exercising, staying active by doing Tai Chi, taking walk, or doing exercise, moving my arms around. I had to do that.
化療醫完之後就沒有做工了，那就家裡就慢慢你們要調理身體，就做運動。 真係改變咗以前嘅人生嘅想法，以前咧壓力大，就要搏命做，依家就放鬆，要輕鬆啲，就最重要就係自己嘅身體健康。
After chemotherapy, I stopped working and it really changed my whole life, my view on life. I was very stressed out before and only worried about working hard. But now I know that I need to relax and really only focus on having a healthy body.
健康是金錢換不到的，還有我在這裡很感謝我們華珠署組織了一個癌症小組。 大家全部都是癌症的朋友，大家可以講下心聲，互相鼓勵下，互相支持下，這個是很重要的。
And there's no healthy body you can buy with money. And I really would like to thank Castle having this cancer support group. We are all friends there. We encourage each other, support each other, and we can talk to each other.
我都很希望社會上多些這樣的部門，即是為那些有病有需要的人，真的得到很大的幫助。
I hope that everywhere will have more organization or groups like that to provide more support to people like us.
是，我们呢一集体活动呢，大家都好开心，好高兴能够聚埋一齐。
Whenever we have gatherings, we are very happy to get together, to be together.
同埋呢，自己要多啲运动，就开心每一日，要做好自己。 要健健康康，快快活活地活著每一天。
So we would have to do exercise every day, just stay happy, stay healthy to live every day.
Thank you. Last but not least.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Christopher Carlisle, and I'm a son to my mother. Mm-hmm. I'm a brother to 5 sisters and 2 brothers. I'm a father to a young lady and a son, a daughter and a son. I have a daughter-in-law. I'm also a grandfather to 2 grandchildren. I am a United States Air Force veteran, but most of all, I am an 11-year cancer survivor. I was diagnosed with lymphoma in 2005. After I went through chemotherapy, I was then diagnosed with throat cancer, for which I had to go through radiation treatment for 2 months. After going through radiation treatment, I found out I had right renal cell cancer, for which I went through a partial nephrectomy. After going through that, while going through my treatments, I was informed by my oncologist about a club called Gilders Club Chicago, which is a cancer-free support community that helped me get through all of my emotional and physical problems. You know, you go through a real emotional thing with this. While going through Gilders Club, you get all kind of support. Cooking groups, cooking demos, just everything just comes into place. While going through Gilders Club, it's only the 2 main people that they help. It's anybody and everybody. Those are the 2 main people they help. And Gilders Club is a group that helps the whole family the whole time. Now, I'm currently not in any treatment at this time. I'm on what the doctors call the watch and wait. Well, that's everybody on earth that goes through the watch and wait. Mm-hmm. You know, I look at it like that. And I do regular blood treatments and regular CAT scans. I participate in Gilders Clubs regularly. And as I stated, I just try to stay active and try to stay happy and stay stress-free. And thank you all for having me here.
Thank you. Let's give our survivors a round of applause. And so the first question, I'd like for each of you to touch on this. Each of you mentioned survivor support, right? You mentioned this, and I want to talk in terms before we move to survivor support, but support that you received while going through your treatment. And what message, first of all, identify what support did you get and that you found helpful? And what organization, if an organization existed or if it didn't exist, what organization you created? And how was that helpful to you while going through your treatment before we move to survivor? So I want to talk a little bit about the importance of support while going through treatment.
Well, for me, I am an only child, and breast cancer is not in my family. I had no idea what to expect, so I had to be fast, furious, expeditious. All the synonyms to describe hurry. I had to hurry up and educate myself on this breast cancer thing. And in terms of support, I didn't have the support because I didn't know. Mm-hmm. No one in my family knew. We were all surprised. And I met a woman who became my mentor, and she has an organization called WOT, W-O-T, which stands for Women on Top. And so she kind of mentored me to help me understand about breast cancer. Mm-hmm. And being my mentor, she helped me establish an organization called the Tasha C. Joyner Foundation, which is a 9-year foundation that I established because I didn't have a place to go. I wanted to create an environment for other women like me who were newly diagnosed and didn't have that support. So Watt Foundation is the foundation that helped me and catapulted me and gave me wings to fly and soar and just to be the woman that I am in terms of celebrating my life. I know your question was two parts, so.
No, but you answered the first part, and maybe we can give the other panelists opportunity to answer that part too. And then we'll talk about what resources you would like to see that you didn't have.
Well, for me, I do have some family that has breast that had breast cancer, and are survivors. But as being a Latina, first generation, my family don't share. So that's, I think, a problem that we have because of our culture. We're very private. And so who knew that my aunt, that I love so much and thought she looked fabulous in short hair, was because she had breast cancer 16 years ago. I just didn't know. So when I was diagnosed, she immediately found out, and through my mom, of course, because she's the news lady, and she reached out to me and we talked. And then I'm not from Chicago, but I've been here 30 years, so I have a slew of really good girlfriends. So that was the first thing I did. I reached out to a girlfriend, and she told me about her girlfriend that had been a 2-time cancer survivor, which knew someone that had a foundation. It was the Watt Foundation, the Women on Top of Their Game. So she invited me to an event, and I got to meet all these beautiful women, and then it started growing into another a foundation, which is the Tasha C. Foundation. So I'm part of that. We're called the Butterflies, and that's because we evolve into butterflies. And I'm also involved with the Brave Chicks from Erica Bracey. It's different shades of pink. She says everybody has a different shade of pink. It's not just one shade. So through all that support, it isn't a support system. We don't call it a support system, we call it a celebration of life, because mm-hmm. we don't go in there, woe is me. It's like, hey, I'm here. Mm-hmm. So that's how I got through it.
Thank you. And I know I've mentioned a little bit already about CASEL already, and can you talk about the services that CASEL or other services that you found?
I
When I found out my illness, I was very scared. I didn't know where to find anyone to help me.
因為自己之前一啲認識都冇，所以咧現在要多啲做啲咁嘅宣傳，等多啲人認識，自己早啲知道，早啲發現，就早啲醫療就最好。
At that time, I had no knowledge of this, so for now, it would be better to have more outreach, more education for people to learn about it, know more about it, to get detected or diagnosed sooner.
Right.後尾咧，就我個女咧成日去教會噶，咁咧就係教會嗰個人真係幫咗我好多，係恩人嚟個，佢就開導我應該點做，點睇醫生。
My daughter goes to church a lot, so someone at church really mentored me, guided me, and talked to me a lot, told me what I need to do, how to see the doctor, what I need to do, and what to eat. And that person taught me a lot.
如果有啲咁嘅病咧，及時得到有人支持同埋開解，心情係差好遠嘅。
If when you get diagnosed, when you have someone to talk to, someone to guide you and help you, it make a really big difference.
嗯，系，咁咧就之后咧就根据医生认为点做就点做，咁咧自己一直要努力支持，一直要撑落去，过到呢个关咧就明显会更好噶啦。
So I just follow the doctor's advice and stay strong and stay positive and keep going, and then it will be better tomorrow.
係啊，咁我咧就希望政府咧多啲咁嘅機構就幫到咧及時需要嘅人。I
hope the government will have more organization to help people like that and provide them immediate assistance.
係啊，因為有啲咁嘅病真係。 唔係開玩笑㗎，真係好恐怖㗎喎。It's
not a joke when you get diagnosed like that. It's very scary.
係啊，真係多謝曬政府嘅支持。Thank
you for all the governmental assistance.
Thank you.
Well, as I stated before, I was a member. I am a member of Gilders Club Chicago. I went in 1999. My father passed away from throat cancer, so I went from seeing him, taking him in the car, riding with him to go get his treatment, and then having to drive him back. He would be so weak. So I knew that I would need some kind of support system when I was diagnosed, and I wanted to know more about it and what I had to do to go through this. As I stated, I went through chemotherapy first. Now, when I first went to chemotherapy, I had no idea what was going on. All I knew is you just go in there and sit for 3 hours and get infused. I never knew that I had to have a porta cath put in. So when I went to get my first chemotherapy, they sent me back because they said I had to go back and have surgery, have my porta cath put in. See, had I been going to Gilders Club before then, I would have known all these things. So that's where I went and got all my information from, for people who had been through things like this before. So that's what I like about Gilders Club. It was very informative. I have witnessed people who have been through going through things like this beforehand, and they can give me information on it. So after I did my chemotherapy, I had to go through radiation. So they could basically tell me about what I would be experiencing. Now, all results are different from each person. You know, it affects everyone differently. But, you know, that's just how it went for me. I want to learn more about what I was going to be going through. And like I said, the last but not least, when I had my partial nephrectomy, you know, I knew what that was about. I was trying to run the other way when they were telling me, you know, what I had to go through. Because, you know, I was, again, of course, everyone gets that why me syndrome. Mm-hmm. But through my support groups and wellness groups, I talked to people, and they helped me out a lot. They really did. It was very, you know, very informative.
So we thank you so much for that, panelists. We have several members in the other groups in the audience. And if you're a part of an advocacy or a survivor group, please raise your hand if you're a member or a part of, not a survivor per se, but if you work for or volunteer for an advocacy group or a survivor group, please raise your hand. Okay. And what are some of those names? We've heard Gilda's Club, we've heard Women on Top of Their Game, we've heard the Tasha C. Joyner Foundation and CASEL, the Chinese American Service League that houses this Chinese American support group. But what are some of those other groups that may exist? Thank you, Erica. And that'll lead to my next question.
One group that I did work with was Sisters Working It Out.
Thank you.
Where we do educate the community on women's health, not just breast cancer, but sexually transmitted diseases, the youth, just women in general, women's health. That was Sisters Working It Out.
Thank you. And it's often called SWEO for those, okay?
Sisters Network.
Sisters Network.
Cancer Support. And I'm the founder of Our Pink Hearts.
What's the last one?
Our Pink Hearts.
Our Pink Hearts, thank you.
Okay, the group I'm with is Access Living, and we work with persons with disability, people mm-hmm. with disability, and one special group is AYOP, and also we have other several organizations that also focus on disability community and women with health and just getting the knowledge out there like you guys are. And we do a lot of networking. Okay. And
thank you. AYOP.
AYOP and Access
Others.
Living.
I'm with the Susan Love Research Foundation, and our primary goal is we're middle woman. We partner with researchers and individuals looking to help determine the cause for breast cancer.
I think there's one more in the back. Can you tell us what Access is?
It's a health work. It's a community health work systems that help to provide free screening mammograms and diagnostic through Illinois breast and cervical cancer.
Okay, thank you for that. So the reason I wanted to do that is because there's several still researchers and academic partners and community partners in the room, and I want our panelists to talk about some best practices. What message would you like for those of us who work with survivors group to know? For example, when I came to work, I met Tasha and Lizzie and Joanne through the group, through the Butterflies. I came to one of their sessions they call Pillow Talk, where they create this safe space. It's really, and I was honored to being invited to that space, because when you walk into the space, it's in our academic language, we call it psychosocial support, we call it, you know, behavioral support, and they create this safe space. And I think by the time I got there, I think they all had provided me support that night. I cried. I wish I were joking, you know. By the time, I was so embarrassed, I left like, oh my gosh, I came as an academic partner, and I just sat there and cried in front of all these women. And I was the only man, and so the man, of course, was crying. But you know, what are some things that you would like for those partners to know about how to work with survivor support and other groups as they navigate people through the treatment process and the survivorship process? Because I've learned so much from you all and just how we can do this work better. But what are some of the things that you would like for us to know that we could do differently?
I think for me, if I were newly diagnosed, I'm 13 years in, left breast mastectomy. If I were newly diagnosed and I was looking for some place, a safe haven, if you will, mm-hmm. I want you to know that allow me to cry. Mm-hmm. Allow me that. You've never been affected, so you can't tell me, don't cry. You've never been affected, so you can't tell me it's going to be okay, because you don't know. I do not know. I think we should be placed in front of someone who has been there, and I can look in my sister's face and she looks like me, and I feel that if she survived, I survive, I can survive. She can give me the necessary tools as an African American woman and say, you're going to lose your hair, it's okay. You're going to gain weight, it's okay. You're going to lose weight, it's okay. Because society looks at you and it's all about the beauty. So it's okay to lose your hair because it's going to grow back. It's okay to gain weight. You're going to lose it. It's okay to lose weight. You're going to gain it. I want someone to be able to look at me and say, it's okay to cry. So.
Thank you. Thank you. It's okay.
That's honest.
That's very honest. Thank you.
I have to agree with Tasha. That was my biggest peeve, especially with providers that see so many patients, and sometimes they kind of get insensitive to our needs because they know what they have to do, and they're thinking, oh, let me just do my job and listen to what I have to say because it's going to get better. But because it's so foreign to you, you need someone to really explain it to you. And my advice would be, if you're newly diagnosed, if you know someone that's newly diagnosed, they must have someone with them at every doctor's visit. Because when I was at my doctor's visit, all I heard was wah, wah, wah. And then luckily I had someone there to interpret when, you know, the clouds were clear. And they're like, oh, what they really said was that you need to do this, this, and that. I'm like, okay. But you have to make sure that that person that's with you is someone that you trust as well. Mm-hmm. So that is my advice, that you take someone with you at all times.
Thank you.
When
you get diagnosed or even a second diagnosis, I still get very scared. So just I would need a lot more support and people to be with me.
希望政府能夠有啲咁嘅組織，就係嗰啲已經患過癌症嗰啲啦。如果有新患者可以幫助人哋，就可以同人哋即係叫做分享下講下過往嘅經歷，就會好好多嘅。So
when a survivor can, when government can provide more organization that would help connect survivor to a newly diagnosed patient mm-hmm. and support them and share the experience will be a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
The only way for someone to understand the pain, the difficulty is to go through all that experience.
如果有這樣的機構就可以幫到很多人，得病的時候就不用那麼擔心，那麼彷徨。
Through such organization, they would be able to help a lot more newly diagnosed patients to feel less overwhelmed and less hopeless.
是和多些組織一下癌症患者的活動，大家聚在一起就開心一點，可以又唱歌。 又跳舞，多啲活動，因為同一樣嘅病咧，坐埋一齊係講話，零舍係好講啲嘅，開心啲嘅。
And to have more gathering or activities for a cancer survivor to get together, can sing and dance and talk together. When you go through the same, when you have had the same disease, you got basically speak the same language. It's easier to communicate and understand.
係啊，咁咧就。 大家一齊咁啊，開心啊，多謝大家啦。When
you are together, so, you get to be very happy together. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. And Mr. Carla, what before close us out? Thank you, sir.
Well, I like to say I agree with the ladies. When you're first diagnosed, it's the denial of your friends and family. It's not your denial. A lot of your friends look at you and think, "Oh, you're not sick. You don't have any cancer or anything." You know, you're going through something, and you need to be as stress-free as possible. Mm-hmm. Of course, when I went through chemotherapy, the hair loss, this is hereditary, so it didn't matter. So that didn't matter. But, you know, it's just your friends look at you, and they just don't believe, you know. But you have to explain to them, if you go into a new relationship, you don't want to go in and tell someone, well, you know, I have cancer. Explain it to your child, because my child was younger then. you know, oh, daddy, you're not sick. You know, children think their dad's gonna live forever and stuff. You know, and I didn't know what was going tomorrow was gonna bring. I was at a point when I was going through radiation that I wouldn't even buy green bananas. You know, that's just how it felt to me. But now, I stay stress-free. I don't worry about it. You know, I talk to people. I spoke to people who've been through what I've been through, and they assured me, just stay stress-free and keep on living your life one day at a time. As I stated, my doctor told me I'm on the watch and wait. And he said, everybody on earth is on the watch and wait.
Thank you so much for that. You all, we're at time, and our time is up today. But again, I hope that what you've gathered from this Chicago Cancer Health Equity Collaborative Chicago Check is that this is just the beginning of the conversation. And if we can give our panelists a round of applause to and thank them for sharing their stories. And please visit our website, Chicago Check, and that's ChicagoCHEC.org, to find out about what we are already currently doing in terms of research proposals, but also go to our Catalyst Incubator grant section to find out about what can and should be funded as well, to give us ideas and meet and greet people that you've met here today that have shared interests. Talk to those researchers, talk to those academic partners to say, hey, this is what my organization is doing, and this is a priority for us, and I don't see this at the table, for example, right? And if you're an academic partner, you heard what our survivors said are some of the things that they need. How can you take this key informative information that was discussed today and turn that into some action or some research question that you may ask as an academic researcher? I hope that today we all do something differently because we were here today. And my ask and my closing to all of you is to do something differently. To A, talk to someone in your family about cancer to keep it in check. If you are a survivor or just anyone in here, talk to a family member about getting screened based on age, family history, and risk factor. Know what screenings you should get based on your age, family history, and risk factor. And then also volunteer. You've heard, I asked specifically for the organizations that existed, so you can find out what already exists. Volunteer, donate your time as well as your resources. If you don't have physical money resources, your time is a valuable resource. Volunteer. You heard some amazing organizations that exist here today. Volunteer. And lastly, come back and share the word. Thank you.